Thank you for the introduction, and hello everyone. My name is Preben and I work since 2018 for the NVOC research group, and today I want to take you along a journey to Antarctica where we studied the atmospheric chemistry and organic compounds in the atmosphere there. So Antarctica is the most southern, coldest and highest continent in the world, and when explorers finally discovered it in the 19th century, they probably only found penguins, because up until today it remains the only uninhabited continent in the world. So due to its specific climate and distance from the other continents, anthropogenic input is very limited because of the isolation. The research question we had is Antarctica still pristine? So our research is based around the Belgian research base Princess Elisabeth Station, which is marked on the map here. And actually, the location is very interesting because organic compounds in general have been understudied in Antarctica. When we look at East Antarctica here, you see there is almost no studies at all. So the dots mark studies on PCB compounds, and you see they are focused around the peninsula and the Ross Sea. The station is also has some big advantages for us because it's a zero emission base, meaning it gets all its energy from renewable sources. So there's no emission of compounds which can confound our measurements. Also, the location is quite comfortable as we can easily reach the coast as well as the plateau from the station. And the disadvantage is that it's only operated during summer, so during our winter. So it's only possible to do active measurements during austral summer. Human influence on Antarctica has not been negligible. So, for example, I think the most known, well-known one is the ozone hole shown here, which is being caused due to CFCs, which have been emitted until the mid-90s. And they cause an ozone hole to form every year during winter. Like last year, we had a very stable and big ozone hole. Another hot topic are the micropolitans, which can be found in the sea ice close to the Antarctic Peninsula, but also local pollution from the stations and the various expeditions which have been going on since the start of the 20th century can have a big impact on the environment. So we wanted to quantify the remote human footprint on Antarctica, which means compounds, organic compounds, which are being emitted in the southern hemisphere, they can be transported to Antarctica using the atmosphere as their main mode of transport. So we want to quantify these micropollutants. And this is quite significant if you think about it, because it means you can have or you can leave a human imprint on Antarctica without ever stepping foot on the continent. And then we also wanted to understand how do these pollutants reach the continent. This is because, yes, the Antarctic circulation is quite poorly understood. So it's a bit a mystery at the moment. How do we get these intrusions of these pollutants? You also have to see organic compounds in the atmosphere are a very minor fraction. And despite being this minor fraction, they play a major role in atmospheric chemistry. For example, volatile organic compounds, they can be oxidized during transport, and the oxidation products are secondary organic aerosols, which are particulate matter, and these aerosols can be very good cloud condensation nuclei. So they facilitate the formation of clouds. And the cloud climate and particle feedback mechanism is one of the big unknowns in climate sciences. IPCC marks it as a big knowledge gap in every report, so I think it's quite important to also research this. So although we do some research on all these topics in the CHASE program, I will talk about the first two bullets today because these concern micropollutants. So if we talk about organic micropollutants reaching Antarctica, we are mainly looking at compounds which are anthropogenic of origin and persistent to some degree. Another important property is that they are semi-volatile organic compounds, and all these properties make that they are susceptible to cold trapping and global distillation, meaning they can hop from a place anywhere close to the equator in several steps to the Antarctic continent, and when they reach the continent, they are cold trapped there and they will never leave. So this mode of transport is long-range atmospheric transport, and it can happen, but there is a big but, namely the polar vortex. So because the Antarctic continent is on the South Pole and it's an actual land continent, you have this very specific situation where there is a very strong air current which is being generated around the continent and actually shields the air masses inside from outside. We call it the polar vortex. So yes, and it's very strong, and we want to get to know how these compounds, the PCBs and the PEH compounds, how they get inside the or through the polar vortex and inside the continents. Then also we have to take into account the atmospheric transformations, which can be very important when compounds are traveling for a long time. So in this visualization from NASA, you can clearly see the polar vortex in effect. So you see the strong circulation around Antarctica. We are mainly interested in the green and white plumes, as they are organic aerosols and soots, which can also be associated with organic compounds. And you see there is a very little influx of these green and white plumes onto the Antarctic continent. But it can happen, and especially during summer when the polar vortex will be a little bit weaker, you can have some influx of these plumes. The group of chemicals we are looking at are the PAH compounds, which consists only of carbon and hydrogen atoms, and their structure is based around these aromatic rings. So for example, the pyrene compounds. They are quite interesting to look at because they are a good tracer compound for civilization, because they are being produced during combustion processes of biomass and coal and heavy fuels, but also generated during industrial processes, namely the fabrication of metal. The PAH compounds also come in a wide variety of vapor pressures, meaning they can be in the gas phase or in the particulate phase or anything in between. So for example, we have this factory here, which can produce some PAH compounds, or they are being released. And they can be both on the particulate and gas phase. And then during their long-range atmospheric transport, they can be transformed, and this transformation will redistribute the fraction on the gas and particulate phase before being deposited on Antarctica. And then for the atmospheric reactions, we are mainly looking at the reaction to oxygenated PAH compounds with the hydroxyl radical. On this map, we will look at the southern hemisphere because this is of interest for us. So below the equator, we see a few hotspots of polyaromatic hydrocarbons emissions. The two big ones are southern Africa, where a lot of solid fuels are being used for the heating of residential and commercial buildings. The other one is South America, where deforestation and wildfires are an important contributor to the PAH emissions worldwide. So when it's so important to study these compounds, you could ask, okay, but why is there then so little knowledge on them? When you want to measure organic compounds in the Antarctic atmosphere, there is a few big challenges you will encounter. The first big one is that the expected levels are very low. So the air concentrations are about the picogram per cubic meter range. This means you need a very strong sampling technique, but also the complete analytical methodology should be very strong to detect those. Then next, there is a very extreme environment of Antarctica, as you can see in this movie. So Antarctica is not only the coldest, but also the windiest continent in the world. And the wind, it picks up snow. You get these tiny ice crystals, which will get inside of your instruments, but can also bury your instruments. So the conditions are very harsh. And then finally, there is a logistical issue. So the logistics, they can be quite complex. You have to get your instruments and samplers there, but also people. And then the logistics on the continent itself can be sometimes quite tricky as well. So you need your samplers, which are robust enough to survive the logistics, but also people who are up to the task. The two sampling techniques we used are high volume sampling and passive air sampling. High volume sampling is an active technique, so it needs a stable power supply. And it's quite labor intensive. So this means we only operated it during near the PE station and only during summer. But the nice thing about the sampling technique is that we collect both the particulate and gas phase fractions on two different filters, so we can distinguish between those. And because of the high flow we used, we get weekly samples. So this is very nice for our time series. On the other hand, there is passive air sampling, so this is diffusion based and you don't need any power for it. And the instrumentation is very robust and low maintenance. It collects the particulate and gas phase compounds on the same filter during 1 year, so you get yearly samples. And because the samplers are quite cheap and easy to use, you can install them at multiple locations, and this way you can get this spatial trend. So this is what we did. We installed 7 sites, marked here with half domes, from the coast up until to the plateau, where we installed our samplers in order to gain this spatial information. Because you can imagine there's this polar vortex circulation on the border of the continent, so maybe there can be a little bit more intrusion at the coast when compared to the plateau. But also on the mountain plateau, there are very strong katabatic winds, which can provide an extra shielding effect for the sites here. Here in the video, you can see myself working on one of the samplers. So you see, it's quite a simple setup, actually. Then I want to show you some results as well. So the first big result is, of course, okay, we can measure the PAH compounds in Antarctica. So they are above the limit of detection and limit of quantification. And you see the concentrations in the air in the gas phase, because this is a high volume measurement, are up until the around 70 picograms per cubic meter. You can also see the distribution of the set of the different chemicals which we found. And yes, you can have a similar graph for the particulate phase pH concentration. And then we had this hypothesis that air masses which are traveling for a longer time, they can react longer with the radicals which are in the air. So maybe we'll find a higher fraction of the oxygenated pH compounds in older air masses. So for example, we have phenanthrene. It can react in the air with hydroxyl and form these quinone or oxy-pH compounds. And this is actually confirmed with this graph shown here. So we see here that the fraction of oxy-pH compounds compared to pH, or the parent molecule, is higher when the amount of pH compounds is lower, which is, we assume, because of the longer travel, but this is to be confirmed with some trajectory analysis of the air masses. So this we did. So we went to our research partner, the Royal Meteorological Institute in Belgium, and they did some dispersion analysis on historical meteo data for all the summers where you measured. And then you get these kind of figures where you see there is a direct input of air from Southern America, but also that's Oceania and Southern Africa can be a contributor to the air masses we measure at the PEA station. Next to that, we also have to consider the indirect effects in which compounds can arrive on Antarctica via global distillation. So for the future, we are now mainly working at the transformations which can happen during transport. And then especially there, we think there will be some significant differences between the winter and summer season, because during winter there is no sunlight at all, and during summer there's 24 hours of sunlight. So the processes can be a little bit different, and also the polar vortex will behave different during winter and summer. Then also the question we are looking into is if we can use the oxy-pH on parent molecule fraction as a proxy for air mass age. So if this is possible, then it will be very useful information for improving the models on the atmospheric circulation around Antarctica. And then finally, as a recommendation, we should expand the measurements which are taking place, and especially in East Antarctica, because there is still way too limited data to make any big conclusions. Especially East Antarctica, it's a huge area and we are only measuring a very tiny fraction of it, so we should invest in this. So thank you so much for listening. If you would like some more information on the project, you can of course contact us or go to our website or follow the QR code, where you can also read my blog from the previous expeditions. Yes, thank you again, and I will gladly answer all your questions now.